think you have in your attachments there, the document itself, this service agreement, I think predates, certainly predates me. And the cost, I think, is determined, if you look about a third of the way down page one, you'll see the flat fee of $15 per student based on the prior fall's audited count. And so fortunately or unfortunately, however you want to look at it, because of we've had a declining enrollment, that cost has been coming down about $4,000 a year, each year that it's been renewed. But I would say, unlike most things where the cost comes down, usually the service or the delivery goes down. In this case, I think we've been actually having more service and more regularity for service and more depth and breadth of service. So I'll kind of use that as maybe a way of kind of kicking off the discussion, which I'll certainly invite Rob Ferrari into and Mary Ann into, to maybe talk a little bit about how I think the origin of this agreement was a one-time, let's make sure the district's ready for online testing. And then as we move away from, and have moved away and continue to really invest in instructional technology and teaching and learning in a really different format, that an internet outage back in 2012 or 2013 might have meant you just keyed in your attendance later in the day. An internet outage now, or next year, or certainly this past year, would really create major issues for instructional delivery, for dynamic student engagement with instructional devices. Certainly, if you think about the number of iPads and Chromebooks and things that we ordered and the team is imaging at a rapid clip this summer, we're certainly moving into a direction where an internet outage is a bigger impediment to teaching on a daily basis than it was 5 years ago. So I'll use that maybe as a way of kind of kicking off the discussion and invite Rob to jump in and maybe take it a little further.
Sure. Yeah, as Ms. Williams was saying, that our network infrastructure is very important. Not only our the wireless access points, because we are relying more on Chromebooks and iPads throughout the district, but also the connections between buildings. So if you think about how the district is laid out, each building has a network connection that goes back to the PRC, and then the PRC goes to RESA, which then is connected to Merit, which is the fiber backbone throughout the whole state. So that is the very important infrastructure piece of it. So to keep up the switches and all the networking equipment, and I can get sort of, I don't want to get too technical, but that is the most important piece. You know, Chromebooks, PCs, iPads, they may, you know, have glitches here and there. Those are easily fixable. But when we have a glitch in the infrastructure, that's not easily fixed. And has to take some, you know, deeper dive investigation. So relying on Reese's team to be able to proactively monitor that, like we do, is very important for the district. You know, we're on top of things, so we know pretty much as quick as anybody in the district if something's wrong in a building. You know, typically it's a power issue, but it could be the equipment issues also. So we're notified. I know I'm notified 24/7 via email. And so is the team at RESA. So we're both, and then once something goes wrong, like this morning, Holland went offline for about 15 minutes, and we monitored that and it came back up. So I mean, we're proactively, like I said, monitoring it, which is the key thing.
So we have a pending A that we're responsibilities, and then appendix B, district responsibilities. So district responsibilities would be your responsibility?
Would be the IT team's responsibility, sir.
And the IT team is you and the techs?
Correct.
Are there other members of the IT team that I don't know of? So are you saying that what the district does, or what RESA does, the district's incapable of doing?
Correct.
And what would it take for the district to do what RESA does?
We would have to hire some specialty employees that are network engineers, that are Cisco certified.
So if we're looking at this in terms of service delivery or priority monitoring versus staffing, let's say we, you know, instead of losing the projected number of kids next year, let's say we gain 100 kids every year for the next 5 years, so we've really turned around the finances, you know, ballpark, in order to build, if we were to hire these positions to get the equivalent support, what would that look like?
To get the equivalent support, you're looking at probably 3 to 4 high, you know, network administrator, network engineers. The one thing about that, you know, is also it's great to have, you know, expertise on staff, but at the same time, you know, we have vacations, we have lives, we're, you know, we would need to build in those backups. Whereas with RESA, we have those backups built in. So if I'm gone, RESA's still monitoring the system and can, you know, come in. If we don't have RESA and I'm gone, or a network administrator or a network engineer is gone, we're bugging someone either on vacation or, you know, sort of out of luck. So to hire that, you know, the, you know, going rates in this area for a network engineer and, you know, network admin, you're looking at a few $100,000 to $400,000 in salaries plus benefits.
To get all the people. If we were to try to employ the same personnel base.
Correct. And level of expertise.
So,
if I may, I mean, so the conversations you and I have had, my understanding regarding this is that it's pretty much the notion is that RESA, being underwritten by the state, mm-hmm. is providing services that essentially no district could fund themselves unless they were a massive district. You know, and because of the size and the scope of the work that they're doing. So it's more than just infrastructure, though, right? Because you're talking about cloud-based email support, web filtering.
They're doing the web filtering, the cloud-based email support. They're also doing the online testing setup and distribution. You know, and then any of the higher level technical support as we have to escalate that up the ladder.
But not all districts have the same contract that we have. Other districts do not have this type of support.
True.
So to say that everyone is using RESA is an error.
Well, no, it's I'll repeat what I said, and I'll stand by it, that most districts could not afford
you
to hire.
You said all districts, and then just clarify the
matter. We can play back the tape. The point is that most districts cannot, except the large ones, which is what I said, cannot afford to have these types of services in-house for the exact same reason. So to have the staffing there 24/7 to support the whole notion, again, of RESA doing this support work, underwritten by the state, is to allow districts to share the costs and have this services provided en masse. Correct?
Correct.
And how is this underwritten by the state?
The cost, my understanding when I looked at it last year and was doing some research, is that part of the funding for the RESA services are specifically targeted to provide IT support for each ISD through the state. I can go back and dig up my notes from last year when I looked this out, but that's the reality. I mean, that part of the ISD's purpose is to support all the districts within it, and that this is one of the services that are done to them.
My understanding is there's different levels of support, and we're paying for an additional level of support that the state mandates a certain level, that other districts get basic support, and we're paying for additional support. That's why not all districts get the same level of support.
Sure, large districts can have their own IT department more economically, I would say.
Yeah, I mean, from my experience, you're either work like with RESA, it's been a, like I've mentioned in the past, it's been a good working partnership and relationship. In my experiences in the past, when you don't have network engineers or staff at that level, you're paying an arm and a leg for the consultants and the providers to do those services. So to have the contract the way it is in my opinion, cost effective, and we're definitely getting our return on investment in those with those fees.
And I would add to that, it's, I believe, based on the discussion and information previously received, it's better from a risk management standpoint. because, again, you're leveraging a greater resource from the standpoint of monitoring. Is that true?
Correct.
And from my viewpoint, if I was sitting here when this contract was initiated with FISA, the purpose of the contract was for them to help us with two things, ticket system and bringing online testing for our kids. And that was, we were unable to do that at that time because we didn't have all of our computers up to date and a lot of things, a lot of training that our practicing staff did not have. So we brought in RISA to help us with those two main things. And then in part of the discussion, you were new and we renewed the RISA contract to give you an opportunity to get your field legs, if you will, and then discuss the use of RISA after that. So in my understanding, what they were brought in for is done, and it's morphed into additional support and network, engineers, administrators, backup, cloud, all of this other stuff. So that was not the original intent of bringing in RISA.
I'm not sure what the original intent was, but in terms of anything that we're doing online, the infrastructure, they are doing the infrastructure piece of it. So without the infrastructure piece, you're not online. So if they came in to do online testing or set up, you know, so that the buildings had wireless access, without that, you wouldn't be connected. And it's not but sort of a one and done. You don't just install it and, you know, are done with it. There's updates constantly because technology changes fast. You've got to keep up with the firmware. And again, I've mentioned in the past, you have to have end of life cycle patterns so that you're not in 5 years, all of a sudden now you're buying up another, you know, 800 access points all at once. You have to have those refresh rates there so that you're budgeting wisely to replace some of the older infrastructure. So it's a constant constant work in terms of keeping the infrastructure up. Mm-hmm.
So this is a discussion item tonight. Then before we vote on this at our next meeting, could we get a list of all the districts in Wayne County that use this same kind of infrastructure support?
Sure.
And those that don't have it before we vote?
I just to add to that, I looked at the contracts going back to 2015, and at least for the last, from 2016, 2017, and going back to 2015, and I even have 2015 in front of me now, the contract looks almost identical. I couldn't say word for word, but I mean, I think it might even be identical. So at least for the last 3 years for sure, we've been operating under the same premise. So, again, I think it's proven itself.
And I know in 2015, we were struggling with internet in different schools, even having access to internet, let alone wireless internet. I know that we have grown exponentially in the last 3 years in terms of student-to-device ratio, internet accessibility.
We get the power of the infrastructure consortium, too, in terms of RISA's putting out to bid some of the internet connections. They're working closer with Merit, and right now we're all on AT&T ASE circuits, and we're looking at being part of the consortium in terms of lowering our prices for our connections, too. So that's a part of that piece as well.